Dear colleagues, welcome to another webinar of the International PhD School on Advanced Oxidation Processes. I'm Lucas Santos Juanes from Technical University of Valencia in Spain, and try to mute your microphones to avoid disturbances. Before starting with the conference, I want to give you some information about the organization responsible of these webinars. The International PhD School on Advanced Oxidation Processes was founded in 2014 by a group of relevant academics and scientists, experts in environmental applications of AOPs. The aim of this organization is to promote the higher education of young scientists in this research field. There is one international coordinator, Professor Luigi Rizzo, from University of Salerno in Italy. There are two more coordinators, one for Europe, Professor Sixto Malato from Plataforma Solar de Almería in Spain, and one for Latin America, Professor Ricardo Torres Palma from University of Antioquia, Colombia. The International PhD School on AOPs involved 26 institutions, 69 scientific committee members, and 116 PhD students and 46 alumni. A student, can be a member of the International PhD School on AOPs if the PhD thesis project deals with environmental applications of AOPs and if one of the supervisors is a member of the scientific committee. The advantages of being a member of the International PhD School on AOPs are reduced fees are applicable for participating in events at conferences, be informed about new positions, grants or conferences, be given the label of International PhD on AOPs and participate in the best PhD thesis awards. These are some students that obtained the label of International PhD on AOPs. And finally, you can see probably the most important event called the Summer School that was held in Salerno, Italy, Porto, Portugal, and Alcoy, Spain. To conclude, you can see the webinars program. And now, let me introduce you, Professor Maria Luisa Marin. Maria Luisa Marin did her PhD at the University of Valencia, working in the synthesis of natural products. After that, she moved to Imperial College, where she spent 2 years as a postdoctoral Pierre and Marie Curie Fellow. When she came back to Spain, she started working at Technical University of Valencia within the group of Professor Miguel Ángel Miranda in the field of photochemistry, photophysics, and photobiology. She was promoted to associate professor in 2004 and became full professor in 2019. Her research interests are focused on the mechanistic studies of different photochemical processes. She has more than 80 articles with an age index of 20. She was co-supervisor of 6 doctoral theses, and currently 4 PhD students are doing their doctoral thesis under her supervision. She has participated in more than 20 research projects, being the principal investigator in 7 of them. She has spent several periods at the University of Ottawa within the group of Professor Scaiano. She has also experience in supervising students and postdoctoral fellows, more than 30. And I don't want to expand any further. Remember that you can use the chat to make your questions. So please, Marisa, you can start with your talk.
Thanks, Lucas. A very kind introduction. I would like to mention before starting that there are people writing to me saying that they have problems joining the meeting. So I don't know if you can be aware of them. But I will start the talk anyway. So before starting, again, thanks, Lucas. I would like to mention that Lucas was my first PhD student, so I think that he was the most appropriate moderator in this talk, and I would like to thank him again for this disposition to participate. Okay, now you are watching my screen, and I will start with the talk. The title of my talk today is Preparation and Characterization of Photocatalysts for Environmental Applications. And I would like to mention that among the different environmental applications that we can think about, I will focus today on wastewater remediation. The starting 21st century still remains a challenge. European Union is very aware of the problem, and they update periodically regulations, water regulations in that sense. In parallel, they have created the list of contaminants of emerging concern that include a variety of pollutants with diverse chemical composition, different origins, low concentrations, and even more important, very difficult to be removed. In that sense, advanced oxidation processes have provided possibilities to create, to generate reactive species that are in most cases non-selective and capable of oxidizing highly degradable organic matter. They can be classified attending to different criteria, for instance, into heterogeneous and homogeneous processes, or into chemical and photochemical, depending on the way those highly reactive species have been produced. According to the number of publications in this area, this is an active research area, and the optimal solutions appears not to be achieved yet. If we pay attention to the different energy sources, light appears as a cheap option, and if we are able to use the light coming from the sun that offers infinite availability, it converts sun into a really sustainable energy source. However, many pollutants do not absorb in the visible, and that takes us into the need of developing appropriate photocatalysts. This will be the index I will follow in this presentation. I will move from one kind of photocatalyst to another kind of photocatalyst. And paying attention to the title of the talk, I will show you synthesis and characterization of examples that I have selected from the literature. I have to admit that there is a huge number of papers on this topic, so even if I have tried to select the ones that, in my opinion, were the most appropriate, probably you are not, you do not agree in all of them. So I will start with the organic photocatalysts, often known also as organic dyes. There is a selection of them here. The chemical structures are shown together with the absorption region in the visible spectrum. The organic dyes have several advantages to be used as photocatalysts. For instance, they are in most cases commercially available, they are usually cheap, show high visible light absorption, they are able to generate reactive oxygen species and or excited species and allow studying the initial steps in the operating pathway. Nevertheless, it is mandatory to characterize these organic dyes. Here I'm showing you the typical ranges of absorption for those organic dyes. And I would like to compare the traits corresponding to a typical reaction in blue, a typical non-catalyzed reaction. When we add a catalyst to a reaction, this catalyst offers an alternative pathway upon decreasing the activation energy of this reaction. However, when we are performing photocatalyzed reactions, they start upon absorption of light by the photocatalyst, and upon absorption of the light, the photocatalyst reaches very energetic states that are called excited states. They are so energetic that from that point, the reaction in most of the cases happens downhill without the need of additional energy sources like heat. However, those excited states need to be fully characterized if we want to understand the behavior of those photocatalysts. In addition to them, the redox potentials of those photocatalysts are really needed if we want to estimate the thermodynamics of the involved processes. Here you can see a simplified Jablonski diagram in which I only want to highlight that upon absorption of light, the singlet excited state is reached, and upon intersystem crossing, the first triplet excited state in most cases can also be reached. I want to mention the singlet excited states compared to triplet excited states are more energetic. However, they are really short-lived species in the range of nanoseconds. While in the case of the triplets, they are less energetic, but they live longer in the typical range of microseconds. In this slide, I'm showing the alternative mechanisms of oxidative photocatalysis. Everything, as I mentioned already, starts with a photocatalyst that is represented by a P in this slide, reaches the singlet excited state and maybe also the triplet excited state. From both excited states, an electron from a pollutant that is represented by Q can be taken, giving rise to the formation of radical cations. those radical cations in the presence of molecular oxygen, I'm moving to the right part of the slide, is incorporate into a chain reaction, eventually giving rise to degradation products. Moving back to the mechanism, those excited states in the presence of water can also generate hydroxyl radicals, and typically in the case of the triplet excited state, upon triplet-triplet energy transfer process, singlet oxygen could be generated. And the form the reduced photocatalyst, the radical anion, in the presence of oxygen. Okay, I don't know, my microphone was mute for a moment. Okay, I was saying that the radical anion can regenerate, the radical anion of the photocatalyst can regenerate the photocatalyst, giving rise to the formation of superoxide radical anion. Those species that are within red squares are examples of reactive oxygen species that can be produced in a photocatalytic process. I would like to go deeper into the thermodynamics of those photoredox processes. And again, if we look at the photocatalyst in P here, upon absorption of light, it reaches an excited state. And in the presence of a compound that I have represented like A, it can take an electron, giving rise to the radical cation of A. This process in an orange square is the photoinduced redox process, and the photocatalyst radical anion recovers the ground state of the photocatalyst, closing the cycle in a thermal redox process. The thermodynamics that operate in those processes are written down in the slide. The photoinduced process, the thermodynamics of the photoinduced process can be estimated using the simplified equation for Gibbs electron transfer that was formerly known as the Rehn-Weller equation. And if you compare that one with the well-known thermal redox process, you can observe that the difference comes from the fact that the energy of the excited state subtracts into this equation. The same happens if the process happens in the way in which the photocatalyst from the excited state gives an electron to a species that we have called here X. Again, the same thermodynamic analysis can be done. I would like to highlight that in some cases there is an alternative nomenclature that is used in photoinduced electron processes, in which the energy of the excited state is incorporated into the redox potential of the acceptor or the donor. In that case, I'm moving down in the slide, in that case, we are calling the redox potential of the excited state. And then the Gibbs energy of the photoinduced electron transfer can be determined only with the two parameters, the redox potential of the excited state and the redox potential of the other species involved. The reason why the photocatalysts in the excited states are better oxidizing and beta reducing agents can be explained using the scheme in this slide. If we compare an excited state to the ground state, an excited state that already has an electron in the LUMO needs less amount of energy to give that an electron than the species, the parent species in which the electron remains in the ground state. And analogously, in the case of reduction, when the species is in the excited state, it offers a spot in the HOMO to locate the incoming electron, releasing then more energy than if the electron has to stay in the LUMO. We can also apply that kind of thermodynamics to the generation of reactive oxygen species. Again, the photocatalyst upon absorption of light gives rise to the photocatalyst in the excited state, and in the presence of water can give rise to the formation of hydroxyl radicals. This is a photo-induced electron transfer process. In the way back to the ground state, the radical anion of the photocatalyst gives rise to the formation of the superoxide radical anion, and this species can, in the presence of water, subsequently generate hydrogen peroxide. I have listed here some values for the redox potentials of the species involved. There are other numbers in the literature depending on the pH, depending on the pressure of oxygen, but values are in the order of magnitude. And in every case, the values I have used are listed in the bibliography down in the slides. So we can apply the same thermodynamics and estimate whether the photocatalyst that we have selected is able to generate those species, those reactive oxygen species, or not. And the last one is the singlet oxygen generation. In the particular case, the process is not a redox process, but an energy transfer process. So the enthalpy of the process can be determined as the energy of the products minus the energy of the reactants. The energy of singlet oxygen is very low, 22 kilocal per mole. That means that most of the excited photocatalysts are thermodynamically able to generate singlet oxygen. Singlet oxygen can be directly detected upon recording the typical phosphorescence as at 1270 nanometer versus time. And singlet oxygen, as also happens in the case of other highly reactive species, is a short-lived species, something like 1 microsecond in water. I didn't give you the values in the case of hydroxyl radical, but are also values in the order of 1 microsecond. With this slide, I would like to highlight the kinetics in photocatalysis. It is crucial to keep in mind that when we are performing photocatalytic processes, the species that are involved are really short-lived. And if they have to find other compound because the reactivity happens in a bimolecular way, the encounter has to happen in the short-lived time. Another rationale can be made for chain reactions that are excluded from what I'm explaining here. So this is an estimation that can be done on the efficiency of a process in which, for instance, an emerging pollutant in the concentration of micromolar reacts with hydroxyl radical with a diffusion control constant in the order of 10 to the 9. So to give approximate numbers, this is good enough. That results into 10 to the third seconds to the minus 1. That process, the bimolecular process between a pollutant and hydroxyl radical, has to compete with the unimolecular decay of hydroxyl radical. If we assume a lifetime of 1 microsecond, that results into 10 to the 6 seconds to the minus 1, and applying those numbers in this equation, that results into 0.1%. So that means that a thermodynamic analysis and a kinetic analysis will save us time to select the most appropriate photocatalyst before starting our reactions in huge scales. We are aware that not only advantages come together with the organic dyes, they also suffer from drawbacks like poor stability, difficult to be recovered, addition of organic mass. In some cases, even they can be potentially toxic. Therefore, their incorporation into solid supports to convert them into heterogeneous seems the logical step forward. In fact, several advantages have already been reported when converting them into heterogeneous photocatalysts. For instance, enhanced electron transfer reactions because of the retardation of back electron transfer after formation of primary radical iron pairs inside the cavities. The stability of the photocatalyst within the cavities is improved. For instance, observed hydrolysis of triphenylpyrrolium in homogeneous media is prevented upon incorporation into solid supports, and the heterogeneous photocatalysts are easily separated and recycled after filtration. Typical solid supports include alumina, zeolite, silica, titanium dioxide. I will focus on zeolites because they are crystalline materials composed of silicon, aluminum, oxygen. They can form cavities that are interconnected, and they are also arranged in 1, 3, 2, or 3 dimensional channel systems. They offer pore dimensions between 2.5 and 20 angstroms. There are examples of several common zeolites here that are distributed according to the pore size. So I will show you several examples of incorporating organic dyes into zeolites. However, the first difficulty appears when the organic molecule fits within the cavity, however, does not fit through the window of a zeolite. The answer that the researchers found to sort this problem was to build it within the cavity in a way that is called shipping a bottle synthesis. This is an example in which zeolite Y, a three-dimensional pore structure with a large cavity of 30 angstroms in diameter, was selected, and triphenylpyrrolium was selected as organic dye. The triphenylpyrrolium cannot go through the windows into the cavity, so the precursors were selected, and upon heating for a week, the organic dye into the cavity was already formed, what they call TPY. So upon the synthesis, I will show you the characterization that the researchers in this topic perform to characterize the new material. For instance, the IR, in which the bands of the triphenylpyridium upon incorporation into the zeolite still have the same functional groups as the triphenylpyridium in homogeneous solution, the diffuse reflectance spectra of the heterogeneous dye compared to the homogeneous dye, showing that still the typical bands absorbing in the visible are shown, or the thermogravimetry analysis to determine the loading of the organic dye into the material. This is another example in which, again, using the methodology of shipping a bottle synthesis, an iron phthalocyanin was synthesized inside the cavity of a zeolite Y. In addition to the typical characterization, I wanted to highlight the direct detection of singlet oxygen within the zeolite, as performed with the researchers in that particular case. Another strategy to incorporate triphenylpyridium into the cavities of zeolite Y was called by the authors as camel through the eye of a needle. In that case, they performed the opening of the cation in acidic media, and in the open form, the diketone was able to travel through the window, and within the cavity, upon drying, the triphenylpyridium was resynthesized. To prove that this was the case, the IR of the dione, the typical bands of the D ketone, were absent in the dry synthesized material, and the bands that this material show resemble the bands of the typical triphenylpyridium. The elemental analysis show the absence of sulfur. Sulfur is contained in the Cantor ion, so the absence of sulfur proves that the cation has not been absorbed in the external surface of the photocatalyst and is counterbalanced the cations inside the cavities. The crystalline structure before and after shows the typical peaks that represent the crystal structure of the unaltered zeolite. Although zeolites are really chemically robust and thermally robust, they suffer from a limited pore size. And in the 80s, there was a need of developing materials that could locate organic dyes, could be used as photocatalysts with higher pore diameter. In that sense, in 1992, the first periodic mesoporous silica was synthesized, and in general, we can say on this new kind of mesoporous materials that they have in common structural properties like tunable pore diameter, large surface areas, high pore volumes, narrow pore size distribution, and very important facilitation of molecular traffic through the mesopores. In this slide, you can see a comparison between different materials, SBA-15 and MCM-41, as very common periodic mesoporous silicas. So the way of preparing those periodic mesoporous silicas starts from precursor of the silica, and in general, tetraethyl orthosilicate is used as a precursor, and depending on the surfactant, the polymerization of the precursors takes place surrounding the surfactant. So in those two examples, in blue, the surfactant used to eventually prepare MCA41, in green, the surfactant used to eventually prepare SBA15. So the self-assembly of the TEOS, the precursor of the silicon, surrounding the surfactant gives rise to a situation that is represented in this corner with this cartoon. The hydrothermal treatment favors the polymerization of the silica, and eventually the removal of the surfactant and calcination ends with the formation of the mesoporous silica with the empty channels. Typical TEM images are shown here, in which the arrangement of the channels can be well observed. These periodic mesoporous silicas can be used as supports for heterogeneous photocatalysts, and there are three different ways in which those organic dyes can be covalently bonded to those silicas. For instance, in the first case, grafting, in which initially the mesoporous material is synthesized, and afterwards the organic dye, represented here by R, is adequately derivatized to bond bonded with the hydroxyl groups of the surface, creating a structure that is enlarged in this part like that, where the chemical covalent bond can be clearly seen. In other approach, co-condensation means that the material is created at the same time in the presence of the derivatized organic dye, the polycondensation followed by extraction ends with again the formation of covalent bonds between the organic dye and the surface of the material. And the third approach that is represented here, that gives rise to periodic mesoporous organosilicals, ends with the organic dye conveniently derivatized to be also the precursor of the walls of the materials. In that sense, the dye is incorporated into the walls and an enlarged picture can be observed in the square. The examples I'm showing to you are examples of grafting that are very convenient and have been developed by many researchers in literature. However, in some cases, we have to be aware that the organic dyes are not directly ready to be grafted into the surface of silicas. For instance, this mesityl acridinium does not have a functional group that allows the derivatization, and it can be incorporated by adsorption. However, chemisorption needs the organic synthesis to make it suitable. For instance, in that case, the researchers decided to incorporate the carboxylic acid moiety since the beginning of the synthesis of the commercially available organic dye. I'm showing here an example of derivatization of perylene upon stirring and refluxing with aptes to create the compound that has silicon ethoxylates in the two corners, able to polymerize with the surface of the mesoporous materials. That was the case when the derivative was stirred, refluxed, in fact, with MCM 41 or with SBA 15. A final washing with acetone to remove the unreactive perylene gave rise to two different dark red color compounds. Then the mandatory characterization of the new materials started with the isotherms, in which we could see that the surface area has been reduced in both cases upon incorporation of the organic dye, highlighting the fact that the organic dye is inside the channels of the mesoporous materials. The TEM images still show the unaltered channels upon incorporation of those dyes. This is the silicon NMR, in which, in addition to the bands typical of the silica materials, we can also see the bands corresponding to the perylene derivatives. The IR of those materials show that the bands corresponding to the perylene are still in the new materials. The perylene loading was determined by elemental analysis, and in this graph I'm showing the diffuse reflectance spectra together with the emission spectra of the new materials. In these two examples, I would like to show you that singlet oxygen can also be determined in an indirect way upon reaction with this non-anthracene. Before reacting with singlet oxygen, this anthracene shows a huge bands in the region between 350 and 400 nanometers. Upon reaction with singlet oxygen, those bands disappear. So, in the presence of the heterogeneous materials upon irradiation, we observe that those bands disappear as an evidence of the formation of singlet oxygen upon irradiation. Moreover, in that particular case, the radical anion that is formed upon irradiation of the material in the presence of an electron donor, like triethylamine, gives rise to a species that shows two bands between, at 700 and 800 nanometers. The homogeneous reaction was used as a control, but upon irradiation of the heterogeneous compounds in the presence of triethylamine, the two bands could also be observed. So then we can move to another kind of photocatalyst that have been widely used in wastewater remediation, that are metal complexes, and in particular among them, ruthenium bipyridinium, RuBiPi, is probably the most used one. It shows absorption in the visible, stable, long-lived excited state, is able to produce single electron transfer to behave effectively as an excited state oxidant and also as a reductant. However, as you can see here, this complex does not offer a functional group that allows the easy derivatization using a solid support. So in that particular case, researchers decided to substitute one of the bipyridinium ligands for another ligand that offers a carboxylic acid moiety that eventually will be the functional group that allows derivatization with the inorganic support. This was the case in the particular example. Glass wool was used as an inorganic support, was derivatized initially with aptes, and those aptes offer free amines that in the presence of carboxylic acid give rise to new heterogeneous photocatalysts. The same approach was used not only with Rubipi, but also with other organic dyes in this paper. The mandatory characterization in which the diffuse reflectance spectra shows still the absorbance that can be compared to the parent ruthenium complex, the indirect singlet oxygen generation, as I mentioned before, the emission spectra of those materials, and very interestingly here in the right down corner, I'm showing an experiment that the authors performed to check whether the photocatalysis observed was homogeneous or heterogeneous. There is always a concern of the leaching of heterogeneous catalysts on the homogeneous phase. There are specific techniques that allow observing single molecules reacting at single catalyst sites. However, they are not available in every single lab. So in that particular case, the authors decided that upon 2 hours irradiation, the heterogeneous photocatalyst was filtrated and the filtrate was further irradiated for 10 hours. As you can see here in the blue trace, the reaction stopped upon removing the photocatalyst as a proof of the heterogeneous photocatalysis. So now I'm moving to semiconductors as photocatalysts. Everybody knows the disposition of the band structure in semiconductors, the valence band, the band gap, and the conduction bands. The band gap is very important because it corresponds to the irradiation wavelength that we are using to perform, to promote an electron from the valence band to the conduction band, and then created 2 reactive species, a hole in the valence band and an electron in the conduction band. However, not only the band gap is important in characterizing the semiconductors, but also the band positions. As you can see here, because the positions of the valence band and the conduction bands directly affect the reactivity of the as-generated electrons or the as-generated holes. Again, different numbers can be found from different sources. You have here the bibliography that I have used to give you those numbers. So I will select titanium dioxide to apply the same kind of thermodynamic analysis as we have used for organic photocatalyst. So upon absorption of the appropriate light, that in the case of titanium dioxide corresponds to the UV, an electron moves to the conduction band, giving rise to a hole with a redox potential of 2.7, and an electron in the conduction band with a redox potential of negative 0.5. So we can apply the same rationale as already applied for organic dyes, and we can consider that the reduction potential of this hole and this electron are redox potential in the, let's say, excited state. In such a way, we can estimate if the formation of superoxide anion is exergonic, and in fact it is in the case of titanium dioxide, and we can also estimate if the generation of hydroxyl radicals is exergonic in the case of titanium dioxide, and in fact, it also is. However, even if there are thousands of papers devoted to use the advantages of titanium dioxide, still researchers are active in that area, trying to enhance its photocatalytic potential. For instance, trying to move the absorption from the UV to the visible, using different approaches. It could be forming different structures of titanium dioxide or doping titanium dioxide with different kind of materials. I have selected here an example in which titanium dioxide was doped with gold nanoparticles. And you can see here from the TEM images that the gold nanoparticles are in the structure of titanium dioxide. The new color of the titanium dioxide is pink, and the diffuse reflectance spectra shows that still there is a band that corresponds to the titanium dioxide in the UV, and there is a band that corresponds to the plasmonic band of gold nanoparticles centered at 550. So the photocatalytic activity of those composites can be tuned using UV light to excite the titanium dioxide or visible light to produce the activation of the plasmonic band of gold nanoparticles. In the case of the use of UV light, an electron is promoted from the valence band of titanium dioxide to the conduction band. The electron travels to the gold nanoparticles, and in the presence of water, hydrogen is generated. There is a need of sacrificial donor to repopulate the holes created in the valence band of titanium dioxide. However, visible light can also be used, and in that case, the gold nanoparticles are excited and an electron travels to the conduction band of titanium dioxide. In that conduction band, again, hydrogen can be generated, and the sacrificial donor is then needed to repopulate the electrons in the gold nanoparticles. Or in the case of another sacrificial donor, a silver cation, the electron that has traveled from the plasmonic gold to the conduction band is taken by the silver cation, and in that case, in the holes of the surface, of the gold nanoparticles, oxygen can be generated. So this is an example of how to tune the photocatalytic activity depending on the wavelength of the light. I would like to show you another example of a photocatalyst that is a semiconductor that extends absorption into the visible, as it is the case of silver phosphate. Silver phosphate can be prepared with different morphologies, for instance, dodecahedrons or cubes. The SEM images show the dodecahedrons and also the cube depending on the selected synthesis. This is the XRD patterns to show the crystallinity of the materials, the diffuse reflectance spectra in which we have compared the absorption of rhombic silver phosphate to the absorption of titanium dioxide, and the tau plot to determine the energy of the band gap. I would like to highlight the importance of the reactivity of checking the reactivity of the new synthesized materials and not playing only with the position of the conduction and valence bands. in that particular case, according to the literature, the valence band and the conduction bands of silver phosphate are located at 2.9 volts and 0.45 volts. That means, and we have here the bands of titanium dioxide to compare. That means that upon irradiation, silver phosphate is not able to produce superoxide anion. However, the production of hydroxyl radicals will be thermodynamically favored. Nevertheless, in our hands, the production of hydroxyl radicals didn't happen, and we check the production of hydroxyl radicals using the indirect detection upon reaction of the hydroxyl radicals with the the benzoic acid in the presence of hydroxyl radicals give rise to 2-hydroxyterephthalic acid that is highly emissive. So when we irradiated silver phosphate in the presence of the benzoic acid, the emissive band was not seen, and as a control, we performed the same experiment in the presence of titanium dioxide under the same conditions, and the highly emissive terephthalic acid was observed. So that means that the thermodynamically favored processes not always take place. So with this, I will move into the photophenton processes, the well-known mechanism of the photophenton process that involves reactivity of iron 2 plus with hydrogen peroxide, giving rise to the formation of hydroxyl radicals and iron 3. Iron 3 is able to absorb visible light, and in the presence of water, reduced to iron 2 plus, giving rise to a further equivalent of hydroxyl radicals. Several drawbacks of the homogeneous photophenton process are listed here: the iron sludge production, the narrow pH range, the difficult iron recycling. And that means the heterogeneous photophenton process seems the natural improvement of the particular reaction. However, the low reaction efficiency of the more abundant iron 3 in the iron salts ends into a low efficiency, together with a high consumption of hydrogen peroxide. That means that there is still space to improve those heterogeneous photophenton processes, for instance, enlarging the surface area, combining with semiconductors to improve charge migration, and trying to reduce the hydrogen peroxide consumption. There are reviews devoted to the synthesis of supported iron catalysts for heterogeneous photophenton using metal oxides, novel metals, iron-containing MOS, metal-free semiconductors, etc. I have selected one particular example because, in my opinion, was quite smart. This is a schematic synthesis of the triple heterojunction structure of titanium dioxide, iron oxide, and a mixed iron titanium oxide. And we will see in the following slides why this bridge of the mixed oxide is crucial for the performance of this heterojunction new catalyst. So the mandatory characterization, diffuse reflectance spectra, they absorb in the visible XPS showing the presence of titanium, oxygen, iron 2 and iron 3. And this is the explanation that the authors give in two different scenarios. In the first scenario, a dye degradation takes place. In that particular case, absorption of light is made by the dye that upon arriving into the excited state is able to inject an electron in the conduction band of titanium dioxide that does not absorb at all in this process. However, it acts as a shuttle in which the electron, if we pay attention to the location of the conduction bands and valence bands of these three parts of the heterojunction, the electron can travel to the conduction band of the iron oxide and accumulate in that particular band. At the same time, the iron oxide and the mixed oxide both can absorb light, can absorb visible light, contributing to the concentration of electrons in the conduction band of the iron oxide. The holes created in the iron oxide valence band travel to the holes in the valence band of the mixed oxide. In that sense, the reconfination of electron hole is decreased, and those electrons in the conduction band of the iron oxide are the ones that are able to reduce iron 3 to create iron 2 that in the presence of hydrogen peroxide give rise to the formation of hydroxyl radical. And this hydroxyl radical is the responsible of the oxidation of the dye. In a second scenario, the phenol degradation, in that particular case, there isn't any dye absorbing, so the only absorbing species are the iron oxide and the mixed oxide, and the mechanism uses the same photophenton reaction as I just described. And just to finish, I would like to mention more recently appeared materials that are the metal organic frameworks. They are made by linking inorganic and organic units by strong bonds, and they have been published more than 20,000 different MOFs. The organic units are in general decarboxylates, but other negatively charged species can be used. And those kind of materials offer a porosity that is greater than 50% of the crystal volume. The surface area is really incredible compared to previous materials. So they have been also applied in photocatalysis for water remediation. Those are the building blocks to prepare MOFs. The general recipe to prepare MOFs is really simple: solution of the metal precursor, solution of the organic linker, and in general an amine is added to assist the protonation of the carboxylate, and crystallization is carried out at room temperature. So the active MOFs can show their activity at different parts of the composite. The photocatalytic part could be A, the metal or metallic cluster, could be found at B, the organic linker, or could be found at the micropore space, giving rise to plenty of opportunities for MOFs. They have already been used for water depollution. There are several reviews mentioned here. And again, I have selected an example in which a MOF in which iron as a cluster has been synthesized, the typical solvothermal process, the characterization, the absorption in the visible, and this is the mechanism that the authors postulate for degradation of organic pollutants. In that particular case, it was rhodamine. I have to highlight that not in this particular example, but recyclability of those materials is really high. They are more robust than probably what one can expect as the first sight. Finally, I would like to acknowledge the opportunity that the International PhD School of Advanced Oxidation Processes gave me to deliver this talk today. I would like to mention the sources that provide the financial support, the Aquality, the Spanish government, the regional government, our university, the Mexican government. And I would like to mention that still there are opportunities to develop novel photocatalysts with enhanced properties towards environmental applications. And with this, I would like to thank you for your attention.
Thanks, Marisa, for your presentation. It's time for a round of questions. I can see in the chat that maybe there is some questions for you. For example, Professor Pulgarin says that under solar light, doped materials or heterojunctions exhibit increased efficiency in degradation rates of pollutants in water between 30% with regard to no-doped ones. Do you think these improvements are enough to change the present paradigm?
First, thanks, Cesar, to be there first and then to create questions that I think are very interesting for us to pay attention and to think again. I don't know if we have to change the present paradigm. If we can find thousands of papers devoted to titanium dioxide, there should be a good reason for that. However, there are further techniques that probably allows us to deeper investigate on the established mechanisms. And doesn't mean that we have to change them, but we can try to provide more evidence on their goodness, or we have to postulate alternative options. Upon preparing this talk, what I found is that the area is really active, really, really active. And there are a plethora, I would say, of different materials that have been used just for water remediation. That's why at the beginning I said that I was not addressing any other environmental application that is for sure really interesting. But I think it's almost impossible to cover all what is published in this area. I don't know if I have answered your question.
You know, can I speak?
Yeah.
Yes. You know, I have a second question for you.
Okay.
Maybe you can, if you agree, you can read the question, the following questions. Until now, could you read the following question, please? Do you see the question?
The question is written already?
Yes.
Let me find it.
Which is related with my first question.
No.
There is another people who can read the questions because it's related with the first one.
Under solar light dope materials is not that one.
No, is that what drawbacks?
I cannot see it, sorry.
There is another people who is able to see the question.
Lucas?
I'm looking for it, but it is a question asked for you, Professor?
No, or no, it's a question for Maria, but it's related with the previous question. You know, maybe I could ask the question again. You know, until now, there is thousands of wonderful, exciting research papers about heterogeneous photocatalysis in the direction focus on water treatment, but there is no even one application. Then my question is to Maria, from her point of view, what are the drawbacks that have to be challenged in order to transform exciting research at the laboratory level to the application? Because it's a little strange that after so many scientific papers, thousands, you can go to Scopus and you can check that there is not only one application. Is why my question: if you apply heterojunctions, doping, metallic and non-metallic doping, etc., etc., and very often with this procedure, the maximum improvement in the efficiency of the catalyst is of zero, very often nothing, to maximum 30% in the kinetics, if these improvements are enough to modify the present situation. That is my question.
I mean, you mean applications in real wastewater treatment, I understand.
Yes.
Yeah, so
because your presentation was especially devoted to that, because you spoke about the water, the oxidative species generating water, etc., etc. Yes.
Yeah. So what I found is a bridge to be made between what is developed in the lab and what we should be testing in the real situations or pilot scale situations. Probably we have a lack of knowledge, at least in my opinion, I have lack of knowledge in the sense of engineering. What I'm performing in the lab, I have to translate into thousands of liters or even more. And in that case, I think collaborations will be really welcome to tend that bridge between basic research and applications. Why not? Recycling and reusing materials in the lab is enough. When we separate the photocatalyst and reuse three times, Does it mean that I can sell the catalyst and I can promise the person that is buying the catalyst that can use it for a month? I think we are far from there. I don't know if we have to try to join different backgrounds to end with a combined solution.
Thank you.
Thanks. I'm trying to do a resume of all the questions we have on the chat. For example, we have an attendant that asks about the possible problems of these complexes, these organometal complexes, when talking about the biological evaluation. I suppose problems in toxicity of these organometal complexes.
Sorry, Lucas, can you hear me? That's Luigi.
Yes, Luigi.
I had up down the end to give. Hi, Marisa. Thank you very much for your presentation. It was really interesting. Unfortunately, I missed the first part of your presentation because I'm committed in a research proposal presentation right now, and so it was quite hard. I would like to provide you with my opinion about Cesar's question and your reply. This is why I interrupt you. And maybe possible application of a photocatalytic process compared to other processes can be focused on specific application, in my opinion. You know that, for instance, in drinking water treatment, no, you have the problem of the formation of disinfection byproducts when you use conventional disinfectants and oxidant, such as ozone, such as chlorine dioxide. No, in that case, an alternative oxidation process is, in particular, if you need removal of contaminants of emerging concern. In such a case, photocatalytic process does not result in specific disinfection byproducts byproducts that are not regulated by national international regulation. So in such a case, this could be an option as oxidation process and even as disinfection process, an alternative to these conventional processes, even compared to homogeneous photophenton, because you know about the drawbacks of photophenton in such a case with the production of sludge and low pH, or eventually the addition of a chelating agent. Another option could be, in as you told, in wastewater reuse application possibly, but in this case, in my opinion, right now is quite hard because we do not have strict regulation about reuse, such as for drinking water. For example, in wastewater use, we do not have any regulation about disinfection byproducts. So this means that heterogeneous photocatalysis cannot be competitive with conventional disinfection processes. And only if, for instance, in Italy, we have a standard for trihalometanes, which are chlorination byproducts. We have a standard for trihalometanes, which is a limit of 30 microgram per liter for wastewater reuse. So we cannot use basically chlorination for wastewater reuse. So I think that in some specific application, there are some perspective for possible application of even for heterogeneous photocatalysis, but we need an input from the policymakers, from regulation, in order to make this process competitive. Thank you.
Thanks, Luigi. Well, I was asking Marisa about the possibility of problems of toxicity with these complexes, organometal complexes, when we use it for wastewater treatment.
I mean, in the case of the ruthenium complexes, in fact, I would be really aware on their use, not only because of the toxicity, but also because ruthenium is not really available in nature. It's not a rare metal, but it's not really abundant. So imagine if we develop something fantastic based on ruthenium, we will end into a bigger problem probably. So I think in that particular case, that paper I read it with interest, but I would consider it more than basic than really applicable option. But the fact that organic molecules can be covalently bonded to inorganic materials and in that sense facilitate separation, and they look robust enough to be used as heterogeneous photocatalyst, I think it opens a new window for environmental applications.
Thanks, Marisa. I can see, for example, that Rita from Milan is asking about, I'm trying to read all the text. Well, I'm going to read it directly. She was like, since 3 decades, a massive research has been done to develop photoactive materials. However, it is disappointing that this eco process is not well applied in real world. So based on your experience and expertise in the field, what are the issues that the photocatalysis process is facing to be transferred to the real world? I suppose this was the question that Professor was commenting. I think it is this question is also have been commented, but also she asked, what do you think about the photocatalysis like TO2 with gold, if it could be used in real applications, and if are there solutions to overcome the issue of byproducts formation in photocatalytic systems?
Okay, I will start by the third one. In my opinion, byproducts are still pollutants. I mean, before we end into products that are not toxic, and eventually they are, we reach mineralization, we are still talking about organic matter, and we still have the problem of produced photodegradation of organic matter. So that means that we have to monitor the reaction, not only keeping in mind the decrease in the concentration of the initial pollutants, but also the decrease in the concentration of the top. And in the case of gold titanium dioxide, I think it was a really smart paper, and that's why I selected that one, in which we could, or they could tune the performance of that composite depending on the light radiation. And that offers the opportunity of understanding how the plasmon surface gold worked, because at that time in 2011, if I remember well, it was not that common to work with gold plasmon bands. So to understand their potential, how they work, I think it was real. And it really worked well in that particular case. And I selected that in the sense that performance of the composite can be tuned, as I already said, but they didn't address the photodegradation of organic matter. That was an example in which hydrogen was produced. And I think the potential of producing hydrogen has other advantages. It's not that easy to produce hydrogen. That means that probably we can pay more money to produce hydrogen. And if we know how the composites perform, I mean, we are creating, in my opinion, arriving to the real application is something that is a real need, because the problem is real. However, in my opinion, research works like a pyramid. I mean, if we don't have a vast base in which the pyramid can be built, we cannot arrive to the final solution of the problem. That means that not every single result as the basic research will end in the final application. However, we will not end in the final application if we don't have a good understanding of what's going on in different kind of materials. That's why, in my opinion, it was very interesting to address different kind of materials with different kind of opportunities and with different kind of drawbacks, because all of them contribute to a better understanding of what's going on. And from that on, I think at least we are closer to the final application.
Thanks, Marisa. Of course, we need basic research to build an applied research and to obtain real applications. I think all of us are thinking that this is an important point. So I think that we don't have much more time. So maybe it's time to end the webinar. And after say goodbye, thanks for attending. And remember that you will be informed about the dates of the following webinars organized by the International PhD on Advanced Oxidation Processes. Thanks, Marisa, for your talk. And best wishes for all.
So thanks again for your invitation. I have really enjoyed the opportunity. Bye.
Okay. Goodbye.
Bye, Lisa. Lucas, yeah. Lucas, excuse me. If I well understood, you record the presentation, right?
Yes.
Yeah, okay. So I would like to remind you when possible to send me the link, okay, to the video. Because the idea is to upload the video in a platform, for example, YouTube, and so we can disseminate not only with the members of the school, but even with the other person that are interested in the presentation, okay?
Yes, of course.
Okay. Thank you very much. Thank you again, Marisa. Bye-bye.
Thank you. Bye-bye.
Bye.
Lucas, I think you have to stop the recording.
Yes, I will do just now.